coming in from Melbourne, Australia, and I've got Daniel Costin, rock photographer, but I've got a VIP guest, Nikos Kolas, the man that's done so much artwork and covers for albums, especially the Monkees, because we love the Monkees. How are you today, Nico?
Feeling groovy.
That's all we need to know.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey, bananas, we want you groovy.
Want you groovy, yeah.
Drive your tune buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
You were telling us a story about going to Paul McCartney's house after Sergeant Pepper was released, and you took photos. Tell us about that.
I was get the lead-up story, because it was with David Jones, and he knew how much I loved being in England, and the Monkees were scheduled to go to London to do 5 concerts at Wembley and film in Paris. So on June the 7th, Davey invites me into the room. He had already got me a job being lighting director on the tour for the 67 summer tour. And he says, hey, how would you like to go to Europe with us? I go, well, I loved you. I was in love with Europe. And I, great, great. Just go see Hal, get a ticket, I got you a ticket, do that. And all you have to do is meet me in Paris on June 28th. Well, that was, of course, a great line. On June 13th, I was on the plane. I get to London, and I knew Samantha just because she was Mickey's girlfriend. That's the only person I knew in London. So I called the BBC. I don't know how I did it, just because it was honest and naive. And I got a hold of their producer, told him who I was, friend of Mickey Dolan's, and I was meeting them in Paris, and I knew Samantha. And could you give me her home phone number so I can call her and tell her that I'm here? He did. He later told me when he met me, he says, I don't know why I did that, because she was a celebrity back then. I could have been anybody, but, you know, I think it was just the straight honesty and simplicity of it that this guy's not a con artist. So I called Samantha, we met, and we went to a place called the Bag of Nails. This was popular back then in the 60s. And to have lunch with this guy named Robin Allen, who was the editor of a magazine called Beat Wave Publications. They publicized a magazine that dealt with the pirate radio stations. Paul McCartney had just done a self-portrait of himself when he was on LSD. And he had to take the artwork out to get it okayed. And he said, would you like to go with me? Well, my heart just leaped out of my chest and started beating. Oh, my God. Yeah. We're going to get to go to Paul McCartney's house. So it was the next day. He was going to come pick me up. Couldn't sleep that night. Eventually got to sleep. Thought I overslept. Panic, of course. Picked me up to go to Paul McCartney's house. And I said, no, later on, maybe you could ask Paul if it's okay if I take a couple of photos. Ease your way into it, you know, whatever. So we get there, he introduced me, I meet Paul, shake hands. Jane Asher was there, but she was went in the back. And he right away said, hey, do you mind if Nico takes a few pictures of you? Oh God, no, what did you just do? And he said, no, as long as it doesn't appear in some magazine saying my day at Paul McCartney's house. I said, don't worry, you don't know how much it means for me to have the only photograph of you like this. So I said, do you mind if I take a picture with you and your dog, Martha? Of course, the song Martha, My Dear is written about his sheepdog, Martha. And he said, no. So we go to the back of the house, in the back door, go in the backyard. He sits in the doorway, and I take that picture, you know, nervously. We go back in the house. We're talking, and I had to ask him, because we are all curious about what Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds was all about. Was it LSD? I said, no. I said, John's son, Julian, was 4 years old and brought a painting home from school. And when John asked Julian what it was, he says, it's Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. So that's what they got the title of their song. Like a lot of their stuff, what was that one? They got the song from the entire The Benefit of Mr. Kite. Yeah. Is that the name of it? Yeah. They got it for a poster. And everything on the poster was the lyrics in the song itself. So we talked more there. I don't really remember. I mean, pretty much remember everything. I just asked him about that. He knew I was there with the monkeys. And then later on, when I left London, went to Nice. From Nice, I flew to Paris, met the monkeys. That whole wonderful story. And then back to London, when we got to London, the Beatles had thrown a party for the monkeys at the place called the Speakeasy. When the monkeys got big, the Beatles flew over the monkeys. My friend Rick Klein and Mickey Dolenz went to stay with Paul McCartney. I think Mike might have gone to John's. I forget who else went where. But that's when Mickey met Samantha, I think, on that particular trip. Because she was a record spinner on Top of the Pops.
And Amazing story.
And I actually went to the Visitor when that first time on the set of Top of the Pops, and that's when Eric Clapton and Cream were playing. And I've forgotten. I mean, they were real nice. I really liked their music at the time. When you look back, I go, oh, man, you know, Cream was really nice. I like it. And, man, he's still around doing great blues. Mm-hmm. Eric Clapton, really, I love blues now. It's my favorite genre of music.
Talk a little bit about, so you were the lighting director for that Monkees tour. Monkees kind of pushed the dynamics of presentation. Obviously, they brought in the green screen, not green screen, the back screen for presentation. Were you guys aware, were you trying to push the envelope or trying to push, you know, like what you could do with a show like that?
I think at the time that they wanted to put on a completely different show. Because when you went to see rock and roll shows back in those days, the Beatles at the Hollywood Bowl, I saw the Rolling Stones, I saw from the hillside. The Beatles came on for like 35 minutes, 32 minutes maybe, played their songs and got off. It was just, you didn't care. You wanted to see the Beatles. That was it. I went every night. It was $3 a ticket.
Wow.
To see the Beatles. So I bought 10 tickets and went both nights. And my brothers and I and brought a friend. And when the Monkees came on, at the time they were really innovative with their concert because nobody put on, in those days, an hour-long concert. Not nobody as big as the Monkees. In those days, it was the Monkees, the Rolling Stones, and the Beatles were your biggest groups. And so when they put on their show, I even knew at the time, I said, you know, this is just way far better and much more out there than any of the other concerts. By having David Price was in charge of the projector, so he did the slides and the filming for the projector behind us. I didn't know what I was doing with lights. I didn't know. I said, Nico, you're going to be the lighting director. I learned on the spot. And by the time I was done, I was actually good at it. So, and the costume change, that was all organized. It was a stage presentation, a show. It was showtime. Kind of what the name of the souvenir program from their concerts was. But it was, I don't know who concepted the whole thing. It could have been from the studios. It could have been the choreographers. Who knows who did it all. But they put on something where they changed the costume, changed the venues in the back. They made it a fun show from beginning to end. It just wasn't up there playing their instruments and singing.
Nico, I just want to say, at the start of the show, the Monkees jumped out of fake speakers, didn't they?
That sounds pretty familiar. Yeah. Because the lights would go down, and then here we come. And then all of a sudden, the lights would go on, the Monkees would come out, and of course they were screaming crazy like they did for the Beatles. It was the same thing as the Beatles in those days. Screaming, raging fans. Lights come on, they play. They might have started with Last Train to Clarksville. I don't really remember.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd say so.
Yeah, believe so.
I mean, I did enough of those tours, but only, I mean, that summer, enough concerts, but I think that's what we started off with.
I'm pretty sure you're right there, Nickel, because you were there and we weren't. But I also got to tell you, you know when the Monkees played the Hollywood Bowl, were you there when Mickey jumped in the moat?
Yeah,
in the
water? I'm the one that pulled him out.
Are you serious? tell me that story.
I said, you're going to jump in the pool? He said, I'm going to jump in the pool at the end. I said, Jesus. You sure it's okay? And I can get electrocuted? He said, no, it's okay. So he goes and he jumps in the pool. I go running out on stage because I was backstage. And I go run out on stage and pull him out of the pool. I said, you idiot. But he liked doing crazy stuff like that.
And what about when he was imitating James Brown in the black coat? And then what happens is Mike would go up to him.
Yeah. This was during the concert, 67?
Yeah.
Well, the James Brown, I know, because Mickey and I used to go to a club called the Red Velvet, which is now Viper Room. It's the Viper Room now in Hollywood. We used to go to Red Velvet on Sundays because it was Hootenanny Night. And Mickey liked to go there and sing. And he liked to go there and do James Brown, Lenny Welts. He loved performing. And he got the, they had a live band, so he'd tell them what he wanted. And he'd also do James Brown. So that's probably where he got it all from, because he liked that stuff. He used to do that, and that's the part I don't remember as much, the long coat doing James Brown on stage.
Okay. Nickel, of all the Monkees, because you were there, who do you think the girls were screaming for more? Were they screaming more for Davey?
Davey, no question. Cute little Davey.
Hey, what about Hendrix?
He was a good looking
kid. What about Hendrix when he was on the show and he gave him the bird? Tell me about Hendrix playing.
I don't think anybody knew. Nobody knew who he was. Two girls at Forest Hills Stadium. I told that story, I think, the last time. I don't know, 14,000 people, however many could fit, sold out, plus the floor area was sold out. Two girls standing on their chairs in the back. I'm running lights. And everybody else is just from the audience. You start hearing, we want Davey, we want Davey. Well, first of all, Hendrix wasn't getting any notoriety. He was famous in England, but nobody knew him in America. And you're trying to play to a Monkees audience, mixing oil and water. It just didn't work. And that was at the last concert he did, because at the end of the set, he takes the guitar, throws it out, and says, fuck you. He walks off the set, stayed in New York, became famous. And that was the end of Hendrix. And he got somebody else. I think the Sundowners might have come in then. Somebody did. Yeah.
When they were doing the concerts and the tours and they were staying in hotel rooms, tell me, was that really crazy with all the girls coming around in the hotel rooms when they weren't performing?
Guilty. I got a part of it, yeah. London was especially crazy. There were always kids outside. When I went out in a limousine with Samantha to go somewhere, to go shopping or something, people were banging on the windows. I mean, they were threatening. They were evil because Samantha was Mickey's girlfriend. And fans don't like it when these big stars have girlfriends because they want to be the girlfriend, stuff like that. But it was always chaos. It was chaos in the lobby. It was chaos outside. Almost the entire time we were in London. They did five concerts at Wembley. But it was interesting. It was fun. I enjoyed it.
Talk a little bit about the inner circle of the Monkees. I know Davey cited you as one of his best friends in articles, and he mentioned Henry Diltz. Talk a little bit about the people that like yourself that the Monkees trusted.
So there's me. There's Rick Klein, David Pearl, David Price. And Henry, of course, Chip Douglas, you got to have him in there. Even Jack Nicholson. Well, Jack Nicholson was around the Monkees set all the time because he was friends with Bob Ravelson. Guy named John London. As far as the girls go, well, Rick Klein's girlfriend, Prue, she was part of it. Then Davey's soon-to-be wife, Linda, came into the scene. She was there in early on, because I remember like 65 or 66, I think Linda was around. Yeah, before the 67 tour.
I got to say, Bill Chadwick, he was great.
Great guy.
Chadwick.
Yeah. Bill Chadwick, great guy. Smart guy. He's the one that took care of tuning Hendrix instruments and stuff like that, so making sure everything was ready. He knew how to set up drums. So he usually took care of doing the Hendrix stuff. We'd carry his stuff in, but when we got there, everybody helped with equipment. When we got there, he was in charge of setting up Hendrix because he knew what he was doing. He was a guitar player, musician, songwriter, and he knew how to do everything. We didn't, so we just took care of all the other stuff, setting up the stage. And it would be the ones you set up don't have to tear down. That's another part of the crew would tear down, take off, so you'd alternate. And then the next time when they come in at 4 a.m. to some town like we did, somebody else would set up, we'd tear down and go, or vice versa, and you get on the cargo plane. And they had a passenger plane and the cargo plane.
What was the biggest concert that you witnessed? What was it? 25,000 people? How many thousands?
That's a good question. I mean, how many did Wembley hold back then? Any idea?
Don't know. 50, 60,000?
I'd have to look that up, to be honest.
Okay, and because I think Wembley was sold out. But I saw a photo of Wembley recently, and I don't remember it to be that big. So did they enlarge it?
I think they did. I think they did, or at least renovated it, yeah.
Renovated, that's what I meant. Yeah, because when I saw it, I said, man, I know that London was sold out.
Mm-hmm.
I know Forest Hill Stadium sold out. I'm guessing at 14,000. It's tennis, so they're not going to have that many people there. Hollywood Bowl, however many it holds, sold out.
Wow.
Minneapolis, I mean, almost every place we went was sold out. It was their first American tour, and they were huge at the time. So if you had a chance, you went. In fact, Minnesota is the one I like best. I did with Hendrix. Because I was able to light the stage in white and then take the colored lights and make a prism so I could cross them. And when I crossed on the stage, it was psychedelic colors go all over the place. Right, Hendrix played. That was my coolest one.
I live in Charlotte, North Carolina, which they played, and that was one of the few dates that Hendrix played. Do you have any memories of the Charlotte gig or the Charlotte. North Carolina shows?
I remember Charlotte, Greensboro. Mm-hmm. I remember doing those. The concerts themselves, nothing comes to mind. You could probably tell me something, and I go, oh, yeah, that happened. But, no, I remember being in Charlotte, Greensboro. So, mm-hmm. Isn't that where Duke is?
Duke is in Durham, Durham, east. Durham,
yeah.
There's some great photos that were taken of Hendrix and the Monkees hanging out in Greensboro at the hotel. And I think Mickey took at least one of them. A couple other people took a couple of the others. Great photos. And I've held 6 rolls of the Monkees that my friend Don Sturkey took at that show in Charlotte. And he missed seeing Hendrix by about 5-10 minutes.
Okay, were the pictures inside the hotel, outside the hotel?
Inside the hotel.
You would have to show me the pictures for me to recall.
I'll forward them to you, yeah.
Okay.
You got to understand, in 1967, I'm in Australia, and the Monkees had just been shown in TV on the 20th of July, black and white on TV.
Black and white, really?
The Monkees on tour. Yeah, I'm seeing the Monkees on tour. That was one of my favorite episodes where they're riding the horses and, like, they're having times off and Davey's chasing the swan around the grass and the Monkees are coming off planes and seeing people. I mean, to me, it's really Beatlemania, but Monkey Mania in the United States, isn't it?
They had the idea of the Beatles and the Marx Brothers combined. Mm-hmm. That was the idea. And we all liked, Mickey and I especially, always liked the Marx Brothers. Of course, everybody loved the Beatles. Who didn't? Maybe a few people, but not many. So Bob Ravelson, of course, liked this whole thing. When they came up with the idea, he and Bert Schneider, I think the two, they're just going to make a sitcom about Beatles, Marx Brothers, make it zany, make it wild, make it meaningless, maybe a slight storyline here and there, hire 4 guys. We've got all the tracks laid down. You got everything. All I have to do is come in and sing, which they did. But to me, the best album they made was the first one they made on their own headquarters.
Mm-hmm.
That's where they played all the instruments. But see, they were ahead of their times as well. because they would invite guest musicians to come in and play. Where in those days, most of the time, I don't think too many people did. I think the Beatles probably did most of their stuff. Maybe in the very beginning, they probably did.
Mm-hmm.
But they brought in all kinds of people. Neil Young would come in. The bass player was Larry, somebody from Canned Heat. Oh, Going Up the Country. One of the greatest rock and roll songs of all time.
Yeah.
I remember this guy, Larry, in there. He's just playing his bit. He was out of it. It's fun to watch.
That's a great song, I got to say.
Yeah,
well, also, I got to say, they had the Wrecking Crew at the start on the first album, The Monkees. Now, that's my favorite album because that introduced me to The Monkees. But also got to say, that song, Steam Engine, I think is one of the greatest songs. And I don't know why the record company didn't release it, because they said the production costs were too much.
I don't remember that. Did they? How did you hear it? Because it doesn't sound familiar to me, Steam Engine. I'd have to hear it because it doesn't sound familiar, but I have to hear it to know if I actually heard it before.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll tell you something. I'm sure you're going to hear it, but I'm going to play it for you in a minute.
All right.
But can I ask you, can you just hold up the albums that you've designed there, Nickel, while I find the song?
Oh, I don't have them all. The only thing I have, no, my favorite one, this one.
Yeah, that's great.
That's the only one I have. I have nothing else. No covers, no nothing.
I was happy to learn that you actually, that originally, when you designed that, that was originally a full color design, and they kind of pared back the colors.
No. That's a huge mistake, and I don't know where Mike came up with that, because I read an interview that they were too cheap to print it in color. I purposely did this in black and white.
Okay.
With just the red, because black and white, especially in those back in the 60s, if you wanted a good war movie, it was in black and white if you wanted the most effect. And I was a big movie buff, and I like black and white movies. Casablanca, all right. They're beautiful in black and white, and they probably wouldn't even be the same in color. This I did in black and white purposely. Did it with felt pens, then an overlay with the Monkees Presents on it. And it never was intended to be in color. And they got to Rhino Records, and I saw they released a CD, is that right? Yeah. With color, and that really pissed me off. I don't know why they didn't contact me to ask me or what they were thinking of, unless they heard something from Mike that was supposed to be in color. I don't know. Because I read somewhere where he thought it was in color, but they were too cheap. Too cheap to print was my Pop Out album cover. That I forget who, somebody owns it now. I've seen it because somebody else sold it.
That single Mummy and Daddy with your design on it here in Australia, They went berserk for the single Mummy and Daddy with your design.
Oh, that red, white, and blue one. Yeah. Ask Your Mummy and Daddy. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was at all the recording sessions at RCA. Or if you sat, I was sitting down at the table and Paul McCartney is, we'll say, just right here. Reach over and touch. John Lennon's next to him. Mickey had brought from the set of the Monkees band of material that Indians used to put on their ankles and like them do the like jingle bells and they do their thing and so on. I'm shaking the bells to the music. I've never met John. I'm a Heisenkite, thinking to myself at the time that John, before John says something, man, do you know where you are right now? Do you know how many people would love to be where you're sitting? You're sitting with the Beatles in London. Couldn't believe where I was. And just as that thought went out of my mind, John Lennon leans across the table, looks at me. I love you, Nico. I love you, Nico. Give me the bells, Nico. Give me the bells, Nico. And from way up there to way down here, whoa. And so I took the bells. And he was so wasted anyway. I threw him the bells, literally. They bounced off his chest under the table. He picks them up, throws them back to me, and catches them. It's not that way, Nico. Not that way, Nico. And that was it. That's my favorite Beatles story of all time.
Wow.
Because when you're as high as I was at the time, and that happened, then somebody to bring you straight down to earth, flustered.
Mm.
That was it. Never shook his hand or anything, but he did tell me he loved me before he ever met me. So,
when did you first meet Mickey Dolenz? Because you've been friends for a long time. Tell us the story about meeting Mickey.
We went at Valley College in September of 1962. He was going there, I was going there, and Rick Klein was going there. We all three met in the student lounge, where you go to hang out between classes. We became friends. Started talking, and I got talking. So Mickey said, "Yeah, well, when I was a kid, I used to be circus boy." I said, "Oh, I used to watch that show all the time." And Rick Klein had been on Broadway, been in a few plays. So we all lived close to each other, and just became friends.
That's unbelievable. What was it like when the Beatles came on the Ed Sullivan Show in 1964 and you guys were together?
I believe that you actually watched the Sullivan Show, and of course Davy Jones was on the Sullivan Show.
Yeah, he preceded the Beatles, didn't he?
Well, he had been doing work on Broadway, but yeah.
He was doing Oliver, and what happens is, Oliver, he got signed to Screen Gems, and then they were looking for a TV show for him. And they came up with the Monkees, and they already had him. He was already signed.
Yeah, Davey was the first one.
Right, correct.
They made it. They got him first, because he's a great performer, great Broadway performer. Oh, but watching the Beatles for the first time on TV, it's like watching Elvis for the first time. Only the first time you watch Elvis, they cut him off at the waist because he was jiggling his hips all over the place. And heaven forbid, 1950s, what can you do? But the Beatles was that was just fantastic. Watch it, you know, it comes on and every single Beatle fan in America is glued to their TV at the time. Yeah, that was really cool back then. Because it was black and white when I saw the Beatles the first time. See, that's like the movie A Hard Day's Night. Early, but way better in black and white than it would have been in color. Mm. Help in color, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Help was way better in color. Black and white, the Beatles, one of the best ever. I saw it 9 times in London in 1964 when I was there, along with Goldfinger, 9 times.
Describe London during the 60s, because that, to me, that's just an amazing, especially 64 to 67 is just this amazing, or even 63 to 67, where it's just, there's so much happening in London. Everything is suddenly it goes from, you know, 0 to 200 miles an hour in terms of
culture and, as soon as the Beatles hit, then all of a sudden we got a taste of English rock and roll. We wanted more. I'm speaking as an American. You're American too, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. But you weren't born, were you born in 63?
I was born in 72.
So you're even 9 years after that. Yeah. Before that, everything was going along normal. Rock and roll was great. Elvis got religion, tapered off. I moved from Sacramento to Los Angeles and hearing number one songs that I'd never heard before because I lived in Sacramento, so they didn't get some of the songs. And everything's kind of mediocre. And my brother John comes home and says, "Did you hear this new group? Everybody's going crazy." I'm like, "Oh, what?" Turns on the radio, of course, on the city station, put on this, "I want to hold your hand." And I go, "Whoa, that's different. I like that's cool." So Beatlemania begins, and you start to get a feel of it. Then everybody's that way, and when everybody else is doing it, so are you. You don't want to be left out. Well, I actually really liked it. Some people may not have liked it, and they weren't along for the ride anyway. I actually loved it. I love music, and I love anything different, especially harmonies. That's a lot of my old favorite 50 songs are with harmonies. And so when the Beatles hit, well, then all of a sudden they bring in the Stones, and then these other Jerry and the Pacemakers comes around. Barry Cross of Mersey, another favorite song of mine. When I was standing on the banks of the Mersey and when I was in Liverpool before going to London that year in 64, that song crossed my mind. Sitting there playing, kicking a football around in soccer with people on the banks of the Mersey. And then almost anybody, I made a statement earlier to some friends or I wrote it somewhere. For my age, when you grew up with music, if you like music at my age, when you grew up, you weren't picky. When rock and roll came around, I liked music, period. I liked everything. especially like classical. I mean, I liked everything, and I wanted to hear everything, and I knew every song on the jukebox. And my brother Dave and I had played Name That Tune, and put a stack of 45s on the record player. Play one note, I know that. Play one note, I know that. You're starving for more. Give me more, give me more. Then the Beatles, then it lays off for a while. I stopped buying records. Beatles come along, and you want to hear more and more and more. Then English rock and roll comes in. And none of these other bands start popping up out of the woodwork. You were starving for more, and you got it. And there was, oh, how many numbers of garage bands turned out to be famous? Now all of a sudden, more Americans are getting recognized along with the English. But I love the English rock and roll sound. I love that. When I think it's 60, when I go back to 67, especially when I hear A Whiter Shade of Pale.
Mm-hmm. Purple Hero.
My favorite song of the 60s. Mickey Dolan's favorite song of the 60s as well. I'm in London. The opening, as soon as it starts off, I'm in London, 1967. And it was just a feeling. I mean, it's not like everywhere you went was rock and roll, but you had it was that feeling of being there. It's the same thing as if you've been to a famous sporting event. And you're there live as opposed to watching it on TV. There's a whole different feeling to it. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm so grateful that I was alive in the right place, right time. And then, true fact, after the party and the speakeasy in London 67, I started growing my mustache, which I've never shaved off since then.
Mm-hmm.
And I told you, when I got to the, we stayed at the Warwick Hotel in Chicago. They were there for a week. They were also, that's where they, I can't remember what song they did. The one with the stripes behind it.
Oh, Daydream Believer. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Wait, my TV's going to show off. Yeah. I didn't go to that session. We were doing something else at the time. Oh, Christ. I lost my train of thought.
We're talking about the Warwick Hotel.
Yeah. And my mustache was going across. I had the Sgt. Pepper record cover with me. I opened it up. I looked at Paul, who's my, because Paul was left-handed, I'm left-handed. I looked in the mirror, and I cut the V out of my mustache. It has been that way ever since. But the other thing was, I hadn't smoked weed at the time, but when I found out the Beatles had smoked weed, even my best friend had smoked weed and didn't tell me, that pissed me off. Because I had noticed a change in him. He became a better person than he was before. There's something different about him. Didn't know what it was at the time, figured it out later. I found out the Beatles got high. They smoked marijuana.
After the release of the first album, the second one, More of the Monkeys, the Monkeys didn't know anything about it. And the story is someone went across to a record shop, saw this album, More of the Monkeys, went back to the Monkeys and said, hey, they've released the Monkeys album called More of the Monkeys, and they flipped because all the songs were from the TV show. Were you part of that group? And were you there when they brought the green album? And they said, look, it's got the PJ, the JP Penny clothes
were
on the album, and it's green. And they released it without even telling the Monkeys.
I don't remember that part.
Okay, that's fine. Huh? Tell me what it was like before the Monkeys TV show was shown on television September the 12th, 1966. What happened before? Did Mickey Dolenz tell you, right, I'm doing this pilot, they're going to release the TV show on this date?
I don't know if I told you before or not, but Rick Klein, Mickey Dolenz, myself, we're going to a school called LA Trade Tech. Mickey and Rick were in architectural drafting, and I was in commercial art. I wanted to go into advertising art. And one day, he said, Mickey says, we would take turns driving to school. Mickey says, next Wednesday, I won't be able to drive you guys, so I have an interview for this new TV show. I said, what's it about? And he said, it's kind of like the Marx Brothers and the Beatles and this and so on and so on. And I'm going up for the part of the drummer. I said, but you don't play drums, you play guitar. I said, yeah, I'll learn. He says, don't worry, I won't get it. But by the time he was done explaining the whole concept, Rick and I looked at each other and said, he's got it. He knew. He was just real negative at the time. But Rick and I knew as soon as he told us about it, we knew Mickey, the kind of personality he had, and he was perfect for it. So the next week we go to school, come back home, and Mickey had been in for the interview, got the part. We didn't know about it yet, but there was nobody around to tell because Rick and I were still in school. So I came up and he told my mom. My mom was the first person he told. He had to come to the house. Hey, I got the part. I got home and says, hey, Mickey got the part in that TV show. Yay! And, of course, when he did, they needed stand-ins. And so Rick Klein, Mickey and Rick were closer, and Rick and I were closer. Rick and I came to Europe together, but Mickey didn't. Mickey had Rick become a stand-in. They left school, and I stayed in school. And that's pretty much how that started. And then even before that, leading up to it, Mickey lived up off the outpost. And we used to go to Mickey's house for Wednesday night at the movies. They would get rent. They would find the 16mm films. Everybody sat there. That's where I met Davy Jones the first time, in fact. And it was a house up in the hills. You had to walk down some steep steps. Everybody sat there, and I'm smoking weed, watching. Well, one of them was that black and white Salvador Dali film. I don't know if you've ever seen.
On the set of the Monkees, did you go around the Monkey Mobile with Mike driving? Did the Monkees hop in and take you for a ride sometime?
I used to take people on tours in the Monkey Mobile. Sometimes I'd drive it. Sometimes somebody else would drive it. People earned special privilege to go in the Monkey Mobile, and I'd be the one that would tour them around Hollywood and so forth. That was Dean Jeffries built that.
How did you come to start designing sleeves for the Monkees?
Because they all knew I was an artist, and I used to bring artwork on the set. I did some really nice drawings of the Beatles, and I brought them on, and they turned the camera around and filmed all my stuff. I don't know where that stuff is now. I left it at somebody's house and forgot or whatever, but long story. And Davey knew I was an artist. Mickey knew I was an artist. And I was going to art school, sort of commercial art. I kind of told Davey I'd love to do an album cover. And when Peter left the group, and they were a little more in charge, which was their downfall, of course, they said, okay, we want Nico to do all our artwork for us, and we don't have to okay it. Whatever he does is fine. So that was having a free hand in art. They trusted me enough. So whatever ideas I came up with, they took. I am disappointed about one, but that was because I'd worked so hard on that Pop Out record cover months and months and months. And it comes in the day, okay, well, we tried it twice. I told you the whole story before, right? About doing all the cutouts, and it was too much to have printed. So I redid it, made it do it yourself, knocked 30 cents off the price. It was still 27 cents or something to have it printed, and that's too much. They told me on Monday, we can't do it, and we need something by Wednesday or you don't get paid anything. I was pissed, and I shouldn't have been pissed. I was pissed, yes. Or I shouldn't have got pissed off and given them. I went with, okay, well, the Beatles had a white album, right? Monkees, you're going to have a black album. Oh, listen, black album, the Monkees' greatest hits. Flip side, same thing. They even spelled my name wrong on the back. Dicks.
Yeah, but that was fantastic because that was actually a very bright orange because I got it for my birthday. Okay. That was my present. It came out in 1969. And I was 11 at the time, and that was my birthday present. But cool. What I want to say is, no, it's true. And I got the black cover. But what happens is in about 30 years later, then I found out that the cover had the pictures of the Monkees underneath but was never released in Australia because I couldn't understand when I saw the album. 11 years old, I turned there, I go, where's the picture of the Monkees? And then I found out and saw the cover where it's got the four Monkees, but Peter had left the group. Yep. So my guess is they pulled the pictures off because of copyright.
Could be. Well, the first album cover, first record cover I did was Teardrop City.
Yeah, that's a beauty.
I did the Beatles that way too. Same style, felt pens. Mm. Good thing Peter was on the right, but that's also where my name was. And they just cut Peter off, and my name wasn't there. And that's all I wanted to see was my name in print. So on this one, I said, these guys aren't going to let me out again. I put it right up here in the corner so they could never cut it off. And I could see Nico Colas. What year is it? 68 or 69? I can't even read. Because I want to see my name in print.
You know, talking to you now, today, I reckon it's been total amazing because we've learned so much stuff from you being there in the eye of the tiger. And as I said, even to be there and pull Mickey out of the moat at the Hollywood Bowl. I mean, how great a memory is that?
There's some fun times. I mean, I've led a really nice, good, fun, full life. Have no regrets. Can't regret anything you do. You just mark it down as experience. And you don't go back and change anything because people, I was the baseball club where I coach, an umpire now. I said, Nico, what would you do differently if you had a chance to do something differently? These guys, they usually don't sit around and talk like this either. I said, I wouldn't do anything. Everything I did in my life, no matter what, bad, positive, negative, every single thing I did, from drugs to whatever, to poverty, to none of this and none of that, has all led me to where I am today. And since I like where I am today, I wouldn't change anything. I'm really lucky to be where I am right now.
Unico, let me tell you, the world salutes you. Monkey fans salute you. The Beatles salute you. And I've got to say, you are something that is just unbelievable. I grew up with your albums. I grew up with the covers. People are still buying those covers. And you are in rock and roll history forever. And I just want to give you so much gratitude because I tell you, when you bought those albums, they were a big deal. That Mummy and Daddy single was one of the greatest singles when it came out here in Australia. I'm just telling you, it was amazing.
Well, the one I sang with Mickey on, the D.W. Washburn, when we were in the RCA, and Mickey said, come in and said, Nico, why don't you and Henry come in here and sing background vocals, harmonies? Because Mickey used to come to my house, we'd have parties, and he plays guitar, and we'd sing songs. And they knew I liked to sing anyway. I had an okay voice. I could never be on stage and sing that. No, stage fright. Henry was a professional singer, and I said, Henry, just nudge me every time we come in. So we did, and I think we did everything in one take, too. And it became the number two song in Canada, 19 in America on Billboard. Somebody said Indonesia was number one. I don't know. But those, the fun times.
What would you want people to know about the Monkees and their, that circle at like 67, 68? Obviously, you guys were all pretty tight. You were, as Plastic said, you were in the middle, you know, the eye of the storm. Talk about the friendship that you guys had together during that time.
Everybody was actually really close. And there was no backstabbers around. If you needed a favor from somebody, they would help you. If you needed a favor from them, they'd help you. It didn't matter who. It was that feeling back in the 60s of everybody. We were like one big family. That's where you get that hippie-type generation. I never liked being called a hippie, even though I had long hair. I bathed all the time. But we weren't into violence and everything. It was just helping people, doing whatever it takes. My first car was a red, white, and blue 57 Volkswagen van that Mickey gave me. I actually bought it for $150, but I didn't have to pay him right away. Paid him later. It's whatever you needed. It's like I said, you know, if you didn't have weed, somebody gave you, I have a bunch of weed here, you take some. I need some help here. It was a comfortable feeling. You could go anywhere. You could meet other people. It's not the snob system that's out today with high society and all the big movie stars and the closed sets and you can't do this and you can't do that. It wasn't that way in the 60s. It was much easier. Much easier to get around. It was a more comfortable feeling. Down to earth. There were no real egomaniacs. Nobody thought they were better than anybody else. If you did, you didn't fit in because people bigger than you didn't have that attitude. So how are you supposed to have that attitude? I certainly never did. I said, I'm just lucky to know who I know. It's not for what I did, from people I knew. That's how I got my luck to be able to do some album covers and talk to you guys about it today. 60 years.
Unbelievable. Now, Nick, I just want to thank you so much for this riveting interview. Everybody in the world, as I said, salute you. We love you. And you know what? Your artwork lives on forever. And we thank you so much.
Well, thank you for having me on the show.
A pleasure.
Thanks a lot, Plastic. You've been a great help today.